A very good morning to all of you, and thank you for joining us for the South Indian Bank Q1 FY21 earnings conference call. We are joined by my colleagues, Mr. Thomas Joseph, EVP Operations, Mr. G. Shivakumar, EVP Credit, Mr. K.N. Raghunathan, EVP Treasury, and our CFO, Ms. H. Chitra. We hope that you and your family are safe and healthy. We continue to appreciate the efforts of our employees who have shown strong resilience and ability to adapt to changing circumstances. Amid the continuing lockdown, with the help of our in-house BCP team, we were able to keep 98% of the branches and ATMs operational across the country, following all precautionary measures as per the guidelines. As on July 4, 2020, loans under moratorium stand at approximately 36% of total loans. As stated in the Q4 FY20 results conference call, we were targeting PCR of 60% in the next 6 months. We have reached PCR of 58% as of June 2020, and we'll positively look forward to cross 60% in September 2020. Now, let me take you through the key highlights of the operational and financial performance for this quarter. I am delighted to state that the bank's operating performance continues to be robust. The bank reported PAT of 81.65 crores for Q1 FY21. We continue to expand our non-corporate portfolio, particularly in the segments of retail, gold, MSME, and agri loans, which now forms 72% of the overall loan book. As on 31st March 2020, the total business of the bank stood at 148,288 crores. Advances grew by 3% YOY to 65,819 crores, driven by continued robust growth in loans under agriculture, retail, and MSME segments, while the corporate loan portfolio declined. Retail loans grew by 10%, primarily driven by increase in our desired segments such as mortgages, gold loans, and auto loans. The share of corporate loans declined from 32% as of June 2019 to 28% as of June 2020. Deposits, excluding certificate deposits, rose by 8% to 82,469 crores. CASA deposits increased by 12.5% to 22,179 crores. CASA ratio improved to 26.9% of the total deposits. Our investment was at 20,601 crore rupees, of which HTM category contributed 16,375 crores, while AFS contributed 4,211 crores. GNPA ratio improved to 4.93% as of June 2020 from 4.98% as on March 31, 2020. Net NPA ratio also improved by 25 basis points to 3.09% as of June 2020. Net interest income for the quarter stood at 587 crores, registering a growth of 10%. Net interest margin was 2.62% in the quarter as against 2.53% in Q1 FY20. Other income for the quarter increased by 57% to 285 crores. Our core transaction fees contributed 49 crores, while treasury income increased to rupees 140 crores. We have already entered into multiple distribution tie-ups with leading insurance companies, and we are seeing strong traction in third-party sales. As we continue to expand the retail and MSME verticals, we expect better momentum in the transaction fee and third-party income in the coming quarters. Operating profit for the quarter was 403.68 crore as against 317.63 crores in Q1 FY20, an increase of 27%, driven by better margins and treasury income. In Q1 FY21, the cost income ratio was 53.7% as against 55.7% in Q1 FY20. The business per employee rose by 2 percentage points, while business per branch rose by 3 percentage points. We expect positive impact on OPEX ratio as we gain from operating leverage from our centralized operations, higher fee income, and increasing productivity from existing branches. The bank has made COVID-19 related provisions aggregating to 100.5 crores against standard assets to strengthen the balance sheet. Based on RBI guidelines, the bank is required to make a provision of 10% in respect of all loans overdue as of March 1, where moratorium has been granted over the next 2 quarters. Loans that were overdue more than 90 days as of June 30 but have not been classified as non-performing were 714 crores. On these loans, the bank has made additional provision of 50.6 crore during Q1 FY21, taking the total mandatory provision to rupees 71.4 crore as of June 30, 2020. Additionally, the bank holds an ad hoc provision of rupees 29.1 crore as on June 30, 2020 to meet any future impact of the pandemic. The above total provision of 100.5 crore towards standard assets is not considered in NPA calculations. Overall provisions increased by 43% to 293 crores in Q1 FY21. These provisions included loan loss provisions of 313 crores. Including write-offs, the provision coverage ratio continued to improve and stood at 58.8% as of June 2020, as against 54.2% as of March 2020. In Q1 FY21, fresh slippages amounted to 158 crore, which were primarily contributed by gems and jewellery and trade businesses within MSME vertical. There was zero slippage from corporate segment during the quarter. Considering the COVID impact, it will be difficult to give a quarter-to-quarter guidance on slippages at this point of time. Bank is confident of holding the gross slippages to 2% of the total advances during the year, taking into account the impact of COVID pandemic. Our overall capital adequacy now stands at 13.49%, while the core CRAR is at 10.82%. The bank has a wide geographical presence with 875 branches, 54 extension counters, and over 1,424 ATMs. To summarize, the bank continues to focus on strong business growth, especially in the areas of retail assets and CASA, favorable loan mix, and improved asset quality. The bank will closely monitor the impact of COVID on our business and assess the outlook closer to December 2020. With this, we open the floor for questions.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Vikha Patra from FairConnect. Please go ahead.
So my question is on capital adequacy, especially tier one capital adequacy. it's 10+%. And if you were to see the scenario for hybrids, AT1, it's the market is very, very risk averse. So for a bank like you, it will be primarily equity. It will be either internal capital generation or raising from the market sources. What's your view, especially in light of COVID, and also since you focus on SME-related segment, don't you think you should be operating at higher capital adequacy and you should have adequate buffers to meet the unforeseen losses?
Yeah, you are right about many of those surmises, but I would also like to highlight that in the last 5-6 years, we have been managing capital on a very shoestring pattern. And I would say that 13.49 is the highest number in any quarter during the last 6 years, 6-7 years. So definitely we are very sensitive about it. We have demonstrated that we will be able to plan out and manage with reasonable amount of capital. But we are open to strengthening that at all times. As the market perception starts improving, we will start looking at all options of raising capital. We will do that. As far as the pandemic is concerned, although we are taking a very conservative view, we have a certain amount of strength in our books because we don't have anything like unsecured loans, a very nominal number that we are talking about. All our secured loans are long relationships, and our portfolios are, built upon the efforts of our branch managers and credit officers and business development officers, not driven by the DSA-DST pattern. Therefore, we believe that we have a lot of strengths in meeting the situation. However, we are open to looking at capital raising at the appropriate time.
Yes, and what would be appropriate time, sir?
We have to evaluate because, as you know, the growth, is not likely to be anything, very large. So obviously, if you look at the capital position, we have enough money to meet whatever expected growth that we are having in our books. So then the question is about our ability to provide for COVID. We have actually upfronted some of the provisions, as you have seen. We have tackled most of the provision related issues on the current book itself and improved our provision coverage ratio significantly. Therefore, we have a little bit of time available. That is what I wanted to highlight. So we will just wait and see how the market pans out, how things are improving. Then we will take a final call on that.
Okay, sir. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Deepak Poddar from Sapphire Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir, for the opportunity. So my first question revolves around your other income. Now, your other income has been quite a lot of variability in last 3-4 quarters, if you see. And since you mentioned about that insurance tie-up and improvement or traction in your other income, so just wanted to understand some sustainability on your other income. Would be helpful. Yeah.
Yeah. The basic other income, that the core fee income, always remains steady and shows a reasonable growth at all times. What creates an element of volatility is the money that is either coming from the treasury or not coming from the treasury. For example, if you look at 2018, practically no money could be booked in the treasury because that is the kind of market environment that was there. Today, thankfully, the market facilitates certain amount of income to be booked there, and therefore we have taken advantage of that. So obviously we have done some transfer from the STM book, and we have booked that income to cover our provision coverage ratio, to take the provision coverage ratio steadily to our goal of 60+. So that is what we have done. Otherwise, this particular quarter, typically what happens is the one-off items are only two. One is what can come out of the income tax refund, interest on income tax refund. That is one number that can come quarter after quarter sometimes. So that is not quarter. Another number that can come is what is coming out of the sale of priority sector lending certificates, PSLC. So this quarter we have a number of around 31 crores coming out of the PSLC sales, because we have got excess priority sector lending, and therefore that money is booked. Otherwise, it is always a steady one, and there is no volatility in the core fee income part of it.
So that 31 crore that you are mentioning, you are considering that as a one-off, that PSLC income?
Yeah, PSLC, what we have got in this quarter is may not be replicated every quarter. It is not possible, because our ability to have surplus. There is some surplus still left with us, but it also depends on how much is the appetite in the market. And generally, in the beginning of the year, the pricing is a little superior, and we have booked that now.
Okay. And also, basically, this quarter we were at about 285 crores. So even if I adjust 31 crores, we are at about 250-60 crores, right? So is that a sustainable number one can assume going forward?
Yeah, it depends on how much we are able to get from the treasury. Like we will definitely try to look for opportunities in the treasury, but it also depends on how much we are able to, gain from the treasury operations. That of course is a number on which we cannot put a fix at the moment.
Okay. Because last quarter the treasury income was about 238 crores, and this quarter was close to 140 crores, right?
Yeah, that is true. The 248, of course, we explained it is partially because we had sold out. It is there in the balance sheet very clearly. We had sold in excess of 5% also.
Understood. Fair enough. And as we discussed in the last quarter, FY21 credit cost 1,000 crores we are looking at. So we are still maintaining that?
Yeah, we said that, you know, credit cost will be around 1,000 crores. And on the basis of our projections, and we have assumed that the NPA accretion will be contained at around 2% maximum. That means we are talking about 1,000 to 1,300 crores of NPA accretion. And then around 1,000 of credit cost that will come in. It might, appear to be a little on the conservative side, but what the piece that we are missing at the moment is what can come out of the recovery, which is not added here when I say all these things. There are opportunities of writing back provisions. There are opportunities of credit back into the provisions from the recoveries. These are the two elements which is not visible in our numbers at the moment, but these are the things that will ensure that the credit cost is well contained at the level that we are talking about.
Well, understood. That's from my side. Thank you very much, and all the very best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Renish B. from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Sir, couple of questions. One is on the fresh slippages side, which was around 160 crore. So, sir, primarily from, as you, highlighted in your opening remarks that some of this has come from the gems and jewelry and trading community. So, do these accounts have not opted for moratorium and hence they slipped, or we have cautiously recognized this as NPA despite being under moratorium?
Yeah, everyone can opt for the moratorium, and standstill close comfort is available. But then we take a very close look at all these things, and we take a very conservative stand. And where we believe, for example, this gems and jewelry, it is a relatively smaller kind of a company. There is no reason why he should have had so much a difficulty. So if he's having a difficulty, then it's better to be classified as NPA. That's our approach. And trade accounts also, I mean, we know there are some, we know the pattern. We know the pattern among all. We got a good portfolio of trade accounts. So we know how the pattern is coming up. So if somebody is having a trend which is a little different from this, then we will take a very cautious and conservative view. That is what we have done.
Got it. So, sir, this in 160 crore, gems and jewelry contributes how much?
35 crores. Trade is 31. Construction is 10. And metals metals means is trading in all these trading metals and things like that, around 10 crores.
Okay. And sir, so now coming to the credit cost side, when you said this 1,000 crore of credit cost in FY21, does it including the outstanding balance which we have to provide on those fraud accounts?
Yes. We cover everything because we have counted everything on that. What is not visible and not counted is the potential upsides that can come from the recoveries and also from the write back of provisions. For example, one account alone in an IBC proceeding, if that gets recovered, the overall provision will come down significantly. Need not necessarily, onto the loan book, but it will come on the SR book. It will come down by 50, 60 crores. So that's the kind of potential that is available. So we are looking at all that. And we are pretty much confident that, 1,000 crore number is a good number considering the emerging position.
A follow-up on that. So this 1,000 crore is also including the potential MTM on SR towards end of the year?
Not at all. Because we believe there is only one portfolio which has given us trouble. Otherwise, no other portfolio, this 1,776 crores that we sold out in March 2017, that alone attracted two doses of provision, one in September 2017 and the other one now. And it is already carrying more than 63% provision. And I don't know, I can't just believe that all these accounts which are lying in IBC these accounts, along with that, we have got some good retail accounts also there. With all these accounts there, even 63% provision coverage is not adequate is something I can't just believe. But anyway, this is the correct position and we are not counting anything for that.
Got it. Okay. Thank you so much, sir. That's it from my side, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Lalit Garg from Global Investment. Please go ahead.
Thank you for giving me the opportunity, sir. Sir, my question is about any strategic investment. Are we looking for somebody to come on board for a strategic investment? Let me explain what I'm trying to say. There are these new share online share trading companies, and I read that they are looking for tie-ups with the banks. So is there any movement, anything happening on that front, sir?
At the moment, no. There are no strategic investment discussions that are going on. Yeah.
Okay. So that was my question. And thank you for taking my question, sir, and best of luck.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Shiv Kumar from Unify Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. So what are the COVID-related provisions that we are carrying on the balance sheet currently?
100.5 crores.
Okay, do you think that will be sufficient given that our moratorium book is slightly on the higher side, that 36% is across segments? What gives you that confidence that you will be able to keep the credit cost low at around 1,000 crores for this year in spite of having a very big AUM under moratorium?
Yeah, so what we are looking at is moratorium is it does not necessarily mean that these accounts are all defaulting or have a problem. The ones who have a problem, and we know those accounts because they are lying in the SMA1, SMA2 kind of or in various other forms of delinquency, we can see that. And that is something, that's the reason why we have this 714 crores which is there today. And that also has come down significantly from what was originally there. That number has also come down. And even there, what we need to look at is this particular, when you say 36%, we also need to remember another one. That is, out of these accounts, if I remember correctly, 21% of the moratorium accounts are having in their liability accounts enough money for covering more than 3 installments. So when we talk about 36%, it is not really 36%. But then we have not taken any benefit of that. We are still talking about 36%. And this is a number that we have to really reckon. That is the comfort that we are having. So finally, looking at RBI's requirement of provision. We are well above that. We have not taken any advantage of deferring or anything. We have taken the full provision and also provided another 29 crores. Then the accounts which are likely to slip, we are again taking a very conservative view, and we have taken a thorough review of everything, and then we are taking a very conservative view that it will not cross more than 2% of the asset side. So that is where the provision numbers are worked out. Then of course the potential write backs, that is also something that we have to keep in mind. This has happened in the past, it can happen in the future also, so we are looking at all those things.
Right. Sir, and especially in the retail segment, the moratorium related loans is slightly on the higher side at 46%, given that you have a very big gold loan segment there and most of the segment is secured. Can you give some color as to which subsegment is giving this kind of a number?
Yeah, I think I should be able to give you that data now. One moment. Right. So the retail segment, we will give the details. If you look at the total home loans, out of the 5,463, the people who have opted for moratorium, their amounts add up to 4,101 crore, which is 75%. Now the fact that we need to remember here is we have given this offer to everyone. It's an opt-out scheme that we have done. That's a main thing. So we have told everyone that you can opt this and to be on the safer side. And then what is the indicative number that we need to worry about? That is, for example, what are the current balances in this SMA 0, 1, 2, etc. So on February 29th. In that group, it is only 70 crores, which means it is only 1.28% of the total portfolio. Of the 5,463 crores, we are talking about a potential delinquency of only 1.28%, 70 crores. And other mortgages, if you look at it, again, that number, the people who have opted for the moratorium is around 52%. But the delinquency part is only 69 crores, which is coming to only 1.31% of the total mortgages. Vehicle loans, it is slightly on the higher side in terms of opting for the moratorium. That is, out of the portfolio, 1,098 crores, 76% has opted for it. But then again, the delinquency part is only 15 crores, which means only 1.37% of the total vehicle loan portfolio. And when it comes to gold loans, the ones who are coming in terms of delinquency, that is the SMA 012, is just 0.04 crores, nominal percentage, that's all. Others are all personal segment loans. The total personal segment loans, we are having only 1,300 crores. And again, here also, the amount that is opted is only 10 crores, which means 0.77% of the portfolio. Then business loans, it is 2,898 crores, but what is opted is only 5 crores. What is taking the benefit under the standstill is only 5 crores, which is 0.17%. So that is the comfort that we are having. In spite of the fact that they have taken moratoriums, they are also significantly showing capability as well as intent to meet the repayment. So that is why the position as on 29th February was a very, very small portion. So that is where the confidence is coming for all of us.
Right. That was very useful, sir. Sir, and within your housing loans and mortgage loan segments, the borrower base would be driven by salaried segment or the self-employed segment?
No, we have actually salaried, which is the most important one. See, when you look at the total home loan portfolio of 5,463 crores, 3,557 crores is coming from salaried class.
I see. Okay. And in the mortgage loan segment?
Mortgage loan segment, of course, it is more like the business class community, which is more out of the 5,252 crores. What we call, LAP business class, that is the one which is the largest chunk there, 3,545 crores.
Sir, and one last question on the liability side. We are increasingly hearing of reports that the remittances from the Middle East are coming down for the Kerala fraternity. Are you seeing a decline in the traction of deposit mobilization for your branches?
It is just the other way. The deposits are actually improving, and you would have also seen in our presentation, NRI deposits are actually becoming a larger portion, ever-increasing portion. It used to be, I would just give a color on that, and total NRI deposits as a part of deposits used to be less than 19% in 2014. Today, we are talking about that as 29.90%. In this quarter, it has further improved. Last quarter, it was 28.55%. Now, it has become 29.90%, which is, it is growing steadily. NRI total deposits have grown by 12.73% as compared to other general deposit, retail deposits growth of only 8% that we talked about. So obviously the NRI part of the business is very strong and growing very steadily.
Right, sir. That's good to hear. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Drishti Shah from Investec Capital. Please go ahead.
Good morning, sir. I wanted to get some sense on the SME segment of yours. So now that, you know, most of the parts have unlocked, what is your sense on the SME and how are they faring in terms of business? And are you seeing transactions going up to normal level or, you know, what level are they going up? And your way forward. Thank you.
Yeah. MSME is a very important sector for us, along with agri. But at the same time, we also need to remember that 47% of our advances, that is all smaller advances, because we don't have bulk advances in Kerala. So all the advances, 47% is coming from Kerala. So one, thankfully, the position is that Kerala, the lockdown position is a little superior, and therefore we find a certain amount of improvement in all the areas. All the areas we find, like, you know, if you look at the people who are talking about the retailers and also the footfalls in various shops and the trading centers, etc., we find that there is a significant improvement in the activity level. And if you look at the accounts also, the cash flows are coming. And therefore, we believe that this is one area where we are going to have some more comfort, additional comfort this year, and particularly in this pandemic, because unfortunately, that is not the case right now in Tamil Nadu or Maharashtra, or areas under our Delhi region. These are other areas where, you know, we have been getting some good MSME business, particularly Tamil Nadu. It was very important. But right now, the Chennai region is not doing very well. So that part is something, you know, that we have to live with. But if you look at other regions in Tamil Nadu also, like in the Madurai region, Coimbatore region, we don't have a significant problem at all. In fact, we find improvement in the cash flows coming out there. So I think it is mostly these very vulnerable, highly impacted metro centers which are giving us some concern. Otherwise, we believe that things can really start improving now onwards. Incidentally, my total Kerala advances is 43%.
Sir, and what is our SME moratorium, the moratorium taken on our SME book?
Just a moment. Yeah, MSME, it is 38.31%. And what is more important is the SMA1, SMA2 accounts which have taken the benefit, that is only a number of 48 crores out of 16,319 crores of total portfolio, which is 0.29% of the portfolio. So this is the number that is actually a very, very important indicator.
So, in our SME, would we have further classification of what is Kerala and non-Kerala in this moratorium? Just to get some sense, you know, because Kerala is totally unlocked.
Yeah, I don't have it at the moment. I can share that data.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sri Shankar from JBRSL. Please go ahead.
Good morning. My quick question is, sir, you have been mentioning about trying to reduce the corporate portfolio. And if I look at the numbers, in the last quarter alone, the above 100 crores are reduced from 40 to 33. Is it correct?
Yeah, numbers have come down, obviously, because, the amounts have moved down below 100 crores. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so go ahead, sir.
Very simple. We are not, wherever repayments are coming in, naturally we would have filled up, but in the current environment, we have taken a very conscious decision that we are not filling up. That's all. That's all what is happening. In the process, we are getting an improvement.
Okay. In line with your thought process of reducing the corporate exposure and moving more to retail.
Absolutely. It is going very well, and particularly in the COVID context, we believe that rationalizing the exposure at the higher end would be the right way forward.
Okay. So on the second side, you answered to a previous question with regard to your home loan portfolio, etc. That 75 or 76% of the amount people have opted for moratorium. Did I hear it correctly?
Yeah, right. I'll just check the number once again. The percentage is right. 75.07% have opted for moratorium. Yeah, that's right.
And of the total number of home loan people, a significant amount is actually salaried class. And despite that, we have seen that option for moratorium is on the higher side. Anything that you can link it to? So I'm trying to get understand, has it got something to do with anything with particularly cash flow issues to a great extent? Because in this housing loan, is it anything related to Middle East connection or people from there who have come back who are not able to repay, etc.? Are you able to make anything? Because this number for a salary class being very high, this number looks slightly on the higher side.
Yeah, so that is where, let us not mix it up with the NRI portfolio at all, which is separate. So when I talked about a salary class, we have got the local salary class. We have an NRI portfolio of 1,009 crores. Again, there also almost 85% have opted for moratorium, essentially because we are also encouraging them. We also told them that there is a moratorium available. In case you have issues, you better take this. But then what is more important is the delinquency as of, March 1st or February 29th. So when you look at that number, it is coming to just 1.98% of the NRI portfolio. That's all, just 20 crores. And if you look at the business salary class also, it is coming to only 1.04%. And much more important is the indicator that I mentioned earlier, that is, of all the moratorium cases, at least 21% is having money with us in the liability accounts covering more than 3 installments. There are other numbers also along with that. Actually, others who are having amounts available for one installment, two installments, etc. also I can read out. So 1 to 2 installments, people have got money, that is around 8% of the accounts under moratorium. 2 to 3 installments, another 5% is having money. And about 3 installments, 21%. So we are talking about 34% of the moratorium people having money in their liability accounts with our own bank covering installments. So that is where the comfort is coming. But as a caution, as a careful approach, many of them have opted for the moratorium.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jay Mundra from BNK Security. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Good morning. I have a couple of questions. So first, just follow up, this 8%, 5%, 21%, these numbers are by value, right? So 34% of the loans have 1, 2, 3 EMI balance, right? This is by value.
Yes, it's by the value. Yes, yes.
So, sir, firstly, on this James and Julie slippages, so just wanted to double check, were these accounts under moratorium or they were not?
Yeah, they are substantially under moratorium, and anybody can definitely take the standstill close availability. We can also extend that if necessary. But our point, as I mentioned at all times, last 5 years, we have not given undue benefit to anyone. We have been recognizing stress where we find that, going forward, they may not do very well. Our experience at all times is to, book the NPA upfront and then deal with it rather than, postpone that. So here also the same policy is being followed, nothing more than that. So we have had a very good look at it, as I mentioned some time back. We know the trend. We know the cash flows which are available with the trading community, with the gold jewelers. So if one gold jeweler or one or two companies in the trading community say that, they have a pattern which is very different from others, then we need to look into that very, very closely. And that's what happens.
Okay. Sir, in terms of retail loans, you have given opt-out to all retail customers. Then how can a customer become NPA? And how can you spoil his CIBIL score?
We are not spoiling anybody's CIBIL score as such. We are looking at the prospects. We are looking at their cash flows. If it is significantly impacted, and we know that the COVID is not going to go away tomorrow. So obviously, we need to deal with that aspect. There is no other way. So we can merely postpone a problem, but it is always better. I mean, this is always in consultation with the borrower also. We tell them that, we have given you all the comforts earlier also. We have, if somebody is eligible for restructuring under MSME, we have done that. And again, so we look at the pattern. What is the position that, even before COVID, how is the trend? So with all that, we take a call finally. And we also tell them that, look, this is a scenario. And it is better that, we deal with this problem and then, close this. That is the best thing.
So for these retail customers, they were given moratorium, but you told them that you have to pay. Is that the understanding? And you have given the moratorium to all, but you selected those inherent weak.
Moratorium is an option given to everyone. Everyone in the bank, moratorium is offered. I'm not talking about a retail customer specifically. I'm talking about retail, MSME. Actually, the most of the slippages are come under MSME.
So only for retail, how does it work? So if a person is under moratorium, yeah, how can it become NPA?
Yeah, like we need to look at his ability to pay, his ability to, there are other factors when it comes to NPA. It is not only his payment history or his ability to merely take benefit of something and then say that, it is going to remain. Then the question is about the DP shortage. If there is a DP shortage, obviously we have to take care of that also. So these are the things that we need to find out. So on the basis of all these parameters, we take a very conservative call on all these companies. That is what we do.
Okay. And sir, now when you say 2% kind of a slippages for full year, do you believe that this entire moratorium of 36% will just become 0% by the time moratorium ends? Because 2% is a usual business as usual kind of a slippages. Right? You actually have had slightly higher, but 2% in general would be a business as usual kind of a situation. So do you believe this entire 36% will just vanish by the... Everyone will come out of moratorium as of 1st September?
We are not saying that everyone will come out of moratorium as of 1st September. But at the same time, we also know that we have got all those people, I mean, their relationships are known to us, how their history, I mean, their conduct of the account is known to us. And on the basis of that, we have always the comfort. We know, it's not as if, you know, we are starting a new portfolio today. It's on the basis of a lot of historical parameters that we have an understanding of how the customer is likely to behave. Now, the one thing that you should remember in the, you know, slippages which are coming out currently, and also the previous slippages that happened over the last 5 years, that kind of corporate book doesn't exist anymore. So that itself is a great blessing for us. So we are now talking about cases which are manageable, people who have the cash flows, people who already have liability accounts carrying money for their installments. So obviously when I talk about 36%, it is not 36%, it is much less than that, because 28% of the people out of the moratorium are already having money for three installments. So therefore, these are the comforts. So a number of around 2% appears to be quite reasonable to us.
Sure, sir. And just last thing, sir, what would be your NR linked retail and MSME loans? So loans which, you know, have some linkages to NR diaspora, NR people. Yeah.
In any case, the whole NRA, portfolio, our total NRA portfolio under retail segment is only 1,920 crores, which is just about 2.92% of the total advances.
Right.
So,
and anything on MSME side?
MSME is very, very limited, basically. It's all substantially home loans, some cases, mostly home loans, and some LAP, and also, some of the vehicle loans. That is about all. These are the fundamental loans. So it's not as if our NRI portfolio on the liability side is very strong. So against the 8 or 29% of the NRI portfolio on the liability side, the asset side is very different. Asset side, on the retail side, what I'm talking about is 1,920 crores. So what I'm trying to tell you is, given that we have had a very close look, we are looking at a number of around 47 crores, which requires very close monitoring. So that is what we are trying to, and that is coming to around 0.07% of the total loan portfolio. So it is not as if NRIs are going to give us a headache.
The proportion is very small at these numbers.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Welcome.
Thank you. The last question is from the line of Rohan Mandora from Equirus Securities. Please go ahead.
Sir, thanks for the opportunity. Just coming back to that salaried home loan customer, just wanted to understand, in case we have had some discussions with them, is there any income impact that they have seen in the last 2-3 months? And also, if you could share, what is the income profile in terms of average monthly incomes of these customers?
Yeah, in fact, what we do is we try to look at the cash flows of the customer during the previous year, same month, current year, same month, and try to find out what is the movement. So such effort is always going on in the credit monitoring department continuously. And wherever weak accounts are flagged, these accounts are given for intensive monitoring by the branches. It is flagged with the concerned region and downstream to the branches for intensive monitoring. Apart from the monitoring which is with collection agencies, which of course collection agency's effort has come down a little bit right now because there are some restrictions about it. But at the same time, this kind of information is available to us, and we can definitely use our branch channel, the relationship channel, to reach out to them and find out what their problems are. But I'm not carrying that particular cash flow number right now, so I can't say that very precisely. But then this is under very clear supervision, and we are very sure about it. And that is why I was talking about the home loan salary clause. The delinquent portion is just about, you know, 37 crores, which is 1.04% in the total loan home loan portfolio. So that is what we are talking about. It is a very, very small component at the moment. So that pattern is what we expect to hold going forward.
Sure, sir. And sir, on this income profile, in case you can share some color, what would be the average monthly income of the salaried account customers? Home loan salaried account customers?
We will share. I think I will tell Vijit to share that information. Yeah.
Sure. And sir, lastly, just small clarification. We have done around 220 odd crores of standard restructuring, standard assets restructuring, but the provision created is only 5 crores. Versus a requirement of around 13 crores. So what is it that I may be missing out there? I understand 5% of the provision needs to be created on standard restricted advances. But only we have created only 5 crores of provision.
I don't know. There could be write-backs there. I'm not sure about it. That number, whatever reconciliation is there, we will give you separately. Absolutely no problem. We have provided everywhere absolutely correctly. And we are not taking any benefit of deferment or anything. Everything has been taken upfront.
Sure, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Pritesh Bum for closing comments.
Thank you for the management for giving us the opportunity to host the call. Thank you everyone for participating. Have a good day and stay safe.